God.
Yeah, normally I'm the one yelling. Before we get started, we're going to make sure we're streaming okay.
Just want you to
That's
know,
not a pee joke.
Bruce made his notes like 2 minutes ago.
That long, yeah. Actually, I wrote them down. That's the weird thing. Normally, I don't write down anything. It is. Oh, because says the old man. There could be an old man throwdown later. We're going to see who can fall asleep faster.
There's still coffee in that.
Streaming team, how are we looking? We're streaming? All right. Ted, we good? We recording?
Wait. Do we have anybody watching the streams?
Good enough. I like Ted.
How many people are watching?
How many people do we have watching right now, Oliver?
He's like none.
What? 105. There's 105 of our friends who couldn't be here today, and they're watching online. So for those that don't know, we'll get to Ted in a bit, but I feel compelled to introduce Ted once again. Ted is the man with the hat working the camera. Woo! Ted's been filming us for a long, long time, coming out from California. I think my favorite Ted story,
the one you tell every year.
I tell it every year. Ted shows up one day after driving cross country in like, I don't know, a day and a half. And he's like, I have cruise control in my car now. And I'm like, wow, now? Like, it came without it, and you put it in? And he's like, yeah, let me show it to you. Okay. And I'm getting ready to go to the garage, and he reaches behind him, and he picks up something. I'm like, what the hell is that? And he's got a stick, and it's got three notches, and on it is written 55, 65, and 75. Jams underneath the dashboard and sets it and flies. So that's Ted's cruise control. And I think that's... it's a good summary. Ted's a very practical man, and we're happy to have him here every year recording. So, yay, Ted. I hate not having a handheld.
Would you like one?
Not yet. All right, so we're going to go through the basics here, get you a little oriented for what's going to happen. How many people, is this your first ShmooCon? Excellent. So let it be shown for the record that it's not all the same people showing up every time. We get a lot of complaints of, oh, it's just them and all their friends. I'm like, I have like no friends. And it hurts.
Wait, what about me?
What? Okay, a couple friends. Honestly, you know, one of the reasons we do this is because we want to expand the community. And it's like, yeah, a slide later, I'll get to it. But there's a lot of reasons why we run the con, but we love seeing new people come here speak. We love seeing new people come here and attend. So it's great to have a bunch of new faces in the audience this year. So first of all, who is ShmooCon? First of all, it's all volunteer staff. You'll see staff roaming around. They're all wearing maroon shirts. Branson's gonna stand up and model a shirt very quickly. This is lovely Branson. He's wearing a kilt. Presumably with something under the kilt. It's a lot of leg. All our volunteers wear the same shirts. You'll go to some conferences and you'll see security is different from different whatever. We've always held that all of our volunteers are here to serve you and to help you and to make the con better. So if you have a question, you can always approach somebody in one of the maroon shirts, ask them. If they don't know, they're going to direct you to the right people and try to get you the help, the answer, the assistance that you need in any way, shape, or form. So, you know, we've done that now for the whole 13 years we've been running the con, and it's worked very well for us. If you don't know, you can't find a shirt, you don't know who to ask, it's a weird question. We get a lot of weird questions. You can go to the reg desk. There's always people. It's always manned. They have radios and phones and reasonably intelligent people who can help you out. So some of them are reasonably intelligent. By the way, that's the high praise. anyway, there are also events from outside that aren't kind of ShmooCon staff run that come in from the outside. We have the Wireless Village, who's run by, what do they call themselves?
Wireless Village.
The Wireless Village. All right, sweet. It's all capitalized. It's a proper noun. It is a catchy name. I have a tramp stamp. It's WV on my butt. Yes?
Will it show you notes? I left you notes.
It doesn't show me notes. This is Keynote.
Keynote has notes.
Okay. Does it?
We're doing it wrong.
All right, anyway. I rail on Microsoft products a lot, but it's hard to argue with PowerPoint, as it turns out. It doesn't suck. The users do. So Tool also runs Lockpick Village.
That would be the call sign for the amateur radio exam.
Oh, we're going to have an amateur radio exam. Who here is planning on taking the amateur radio exam?
They're all studying.
I have one hand in the back. Yeah, the rest are all studying. Shmoogonography and unallocated as well running. So just so you know, there's events that we run institutionally as ShmooCon, and we fund and are run by kind of our staff, and then there's these outside organizations who just done this on their own. They bring in their own kit. They do their own thing. We try to support them where we can, but you'll see some of these same people in other locations. You see the Wireless Village people at DEF CON and at DerbyCon, and you'll see Tool at, like, every frickin' HackerCon in the country, right? Like, they're all over the place. So we really appreciate them bringing their expertise, bringing their time and energy, and giving you all something additional to do when you come to ShmooCon. So from your memory of the notes, am I missing anything?
Not on that one, you're good.
Sweet! All right, next up, we got sponsors. As you can tell, they're in your program, they're online. It's funny. Sponsorship is an interesting thing for us, right? We are in this really rarefied space of conference running where I don't know if you're aware, but we sell out. Sellouts. And what's interesting is that affords us this huge luxury of knowing coming in the door, we're going to have a certain amount of revenue that we raise, right? And we also limit sponsorship because we want this to be a valuable thing for the sponsors as well. Plus, we actually don't need that much extra money to make the con awesome. Like, we can run the con with what you all pay, and the sponsors just add additional awesomeness. They help cover the party on Saturday night and that kind of thing. So, we tell sponsors no a lot. Which is really weird for some of these larger institutions to say, you know, big corporate PR people, like, we would like to sponsor, and we're like, cool, no. like, no one's never not taken our money before. I'm like, well, welcome to a whole new world. Like, you know. But the sponsors, like, so Heidi does this back and forth with them, where she sends a very clear email, like, here are the things that I need from you. Not, what, am I not allowed to have this conversation? I will be very careful. I'm not. No names will be used. I'll make fake names. Micro squish.
Not a sponsor.
Not a sponsor. So just to be clear, I was not a sponsor. I really obfuscated the hell out of that one. So anyway, she sends this very clear email. I need these things, and in return, you'll get things like, you give me money, and then we will provide you with barcodes, okay? You give me a logo, and we will put it on the website, and then put it into print. And invariably, people will be like, where are my barcodes? They're like, where's your fucking money? Why isn't my logo on the website? Well, because you haven't given it to us, okay? These very simple logic problems, right? But they're beyond some marketing people to understand. So, or the tech people, or whatever. What's interesting is that the first thing that happens is we put the logo on the website. How many of you, when you go to a conference, do you go and see who sponsored it on the website? It's because you're a vendor. Like, that's... How many non-vendors go there? Like, it's somewhat fascinating. Like, if we were to look at the traffic logs, I bet that 98% of the traffic on the sponsor page are other sponsors. It had nothing to do with you all. So, ignoring the tombstone chart that is like the sponsor page and what's on your banner or in your programs, one thing that we've done, again, from the early days is encourage our sponsors to do something different, right? We don't give them a lot of space. Like, you cannot set up a pop-up thing behind you. People are like, hey, will my 12x12 booth fit here? No, absolutely, it will fit in the dumpster outside. The TSA will take it from you if you want. They're really good at throwing crap away. But at the end of the day, you know, you have a 6-foot table, and you have to engage with the audience, right? And we've had people show up, just treat it like a vendor show. We had, I can't remember, one company show up, and guys showed up in suits with some pamphlets.
On day one.
Day two, they were like, screw this shit, t-shirts, you know? At least people will approach us. No, it wasn't them, it was somebody else. But it was interesting, you know, because there's a lot of energy gone into those booths out there, right? There's lots of games, there's lots of giveaways, there's prizes, there's people really trying to show their wares. We've always reserved our lower level sponsorship for startup companies that have only been around less than 3 years, limited number of employees, and we try to give them the same kind of exposure that other bigger companies that can buy at higher levels get. Right. Again, this is something we try to do, because, again, we have the luxury to be able to do that, to promote new and upcoming companies in the community. So, you know, please go out, talk to the sponsors, see what they've got, play the games, play the contests, whatever. Am I missing any notes now?
You're good.
Okay. I'm getting a little philosophical. I'm sorry.
He is.
I am. That's what makes me me. And I only dropped one F-bomb. So far. So far, it's a running tally. So I don't know. Quick story. Is Beetle in the audience?
Beetle is
here. He's here. I don't know where he is. Okay. So he has heard me speak. So Beetle and I used to speak together a lot. And I was at Booz Allen for a while. For some of you who don't know me, that may be a shocker. But I was at Booz Allen, and Beetle and I, we did a lot of wireless security talks, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, that kind of thing. And I had gotten in trouble from the Booz Allen PR people because I was swearing on stage. I actually got quoted saying something like, "We haven't accomplished a goddamn thing in the last 40 years," says Bruce Potter of Booz Allen Hamilton. No, they didn't say fuck in the article. But later on, like, I said fuck a lot on that talk. And the PR person was like, really, like 80s keeping track. You're gonna run out of digits real quick, buddy. Fuck. How many was that? bring it on. So,
you don't work for yourself anymore?
I have an employer now. anyway. So I go. Beetle and I are gonna give a talk at Black Hat DC back when that was a thing. It was like the second one. It was out at some bar or something out in frickin' Tyson's. And I'm like, "Hey, Beetle, man, like, really, I gotta tone it down. Like, I gotta not say fuck so much, and, you know, really ratchet down. I got, you know, like to keep my job and all that." He's like, "Okay, cool, we can do that." I'm like, "All right." So we get up on stage, we're doing the intros, and he just like grabs the mic and he's like, "Hey, I gotta say something." I'm like, "Oh shit." Says Bruce has gotten in trouble for swearing, so we want to make sure that nothing happens today. Okay, everybody cool with that? They're like, "Yep." And he hits space. It's just fuck in like 1,000-point letters on the next slide. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, anymore, I don't swear when I speak anymore. So I apologize. So, boom, boom. Fuck that. So, who else is here? We've got. Who cares? I'm just like, wow, there's slides. This is a bit like whose slide. I'm just going to go with each slide and see what it says. We got 61 speakers and 33 tracks, 35 tracks, or 35 slots.
We have four tracks. We have 35.
35 tracks. What does this look like, RSA? Sorry. I offended someone in the audience. So 44 of them are new to speaking to ShmooCon, which is great. And again,
I think 14 of those, roughly 14 of those, are new to speaking in general. The others have spoken at other venues, but not at ShmooCon, just to break down that number for you.
So, that was a rousing round of applause, by the way. I feel like Jeb Bush, now you clap. There we go, yeah, sorry. Also, was that a harmonica? The fuck just happened? Oh, the drugs are kicking in. All right, so anyway, and again, this is the thing. It's interesting because, this is a volunteer event. We run this. We try to be as oriented to you as attendees as we can be. And we do have faced a lot of criticism about, oh, it's the same speakers. It's just their friends speaking and that kind of thing. Like, man, when 66% of the people who are speaking here have never spoken here before, like, that's a supermajority, right? That gets past, like, filibuster-type material.
I got more stats.
Oh, you got more stats?
You want more stats?
Yeah, more stats.
One more stats. I think it's, David, you're going to have to help me here, but it's just under 90% of our speakers have only spoken at ShmooCon one or two times. Most of those are once. The speakers who have spoken 3, 4, and 5 times, the majority of those are repeats because of our first 4 years when repeat speakers were kind of the thing because everybody went, ShmooCon, what's that? So we're pretty proud of that. We think it's cool. We've always put an emphasis on new folks, new topics, new speakers. And I think we've accomplished that.
Yay. Hello. Can I get one of the wireless mics lit up? Yes. Hello. Oh, it's going to be in stereo. Hello. There we go. Okay. Sorry. I'm going to walk around now because I can't take this podium shit. So attendees, so now we've gone through staff, we've gone through speakers, we've gone through the sponsors, now it's the unwasp masses, right? We have the schmoozers and students. So for those that don't know...
Who schmoozed a student?
Who schmoozed a student? This is not an illegal thing, by the way. This is totally legal.
All right, so schmoozers.
Schmoozers. So,
schmoozers.
Yeah, you want to explain it?
I don't know.
Okay, sweet.
He'll get it wrong. I'm just here for more.
I'm going to make this shit up, and she's going to correct me. What's interesting is we've had a very large participation by students in the last since we started, but the vast majority of them were actually West Point cadets. West Point brings down the busload of cadets, like 40-odd cadets each year, and that's been a great relationship, but we haven't really historically had a strong relationship with the academic community in general. And so a few years ago, we started doing Shmooze a Student as a formal program, where the idea is people would sponsor students to come here. So they would pay $400. Oh, I've been paying attention. $400, and that would cover their own ticket, a ticket for a student, and a $100 stipend, of which we would then chip in an extra $100, so they would get a $200 stipend total for showing up. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Man, look at that. Man, this is where you clap. I thought you want to go through the stats. You're the stat lady.
I'm the stat lady.
You're Elias Sports.
I am not. What?
Elias Sports.
I don't know.
You ever wonder how Elias Sports does that? I actually tried to get them to come keynote one year, and I didn't get a response. So if anyone has a hook into Elias, I would love to know how they figure their shit out so fast.
Is it bad that I don't know who you're talking about?
Elias Sports. They're the ones that come up with, like, on a Tuesday, on even-numbered months, this hitter bats 460 from the left-hand side. You're like, how the fuck did you know that? You know, it's like, oh, it's this monster database, and they've been doing this since, like, the 80s,
computers.
Right?
Computers.
They just make it up. Elias Sports is the biggest fake news ever.
Fake news.
Tim Tebow is the greatest quarterback of all time. So there's no one watches football. There's no overlap between football and hackers, right? Like, I just determined that.
I wrote the opening to be short.
Oh, shit, sorry. Okay, so anyway, here's the deal.
Your slide's at the end.
Okay, all right. Okay. We opened up 25 spots for schmoozers and students. We had 30 schmoozers apply, and we accepted 30 people's money. We had 75 students apply.
And we accepted every single one of them.
Accepted every one of them. So that means we covered their ticket, and we covered their stipend. So we got a whole bunch of students in, and then there was a kind of a meetup that we had before the con.
So we got schmoozed. Who's a student in the audience if y'all made it in here? So that's a lot of you.
Nice.
A lot of you are here.
And then finally, the rest of you. So you're all important, but you're in a different class, which is just the generic second person. You.
But we like you. It says so right up there.
We like you. I'm trying to pick my nose.
It's a small font. I'm sorry. I should have made it bigger.
All right. So on to the what. So we have the talks. Is this where you had notes to me?
Not yet. You're good.
Okay, I'll keep cruising then. And so it's funny because a lot of people think of, like, the talks as the con, but honestly, there's a lot more to the con. We've had a few people, you know, especially on government, like, my manager won't approve me to go to the con until they see the talks that are going to be there. And, like, you do know there's a lot more than that, right? Like, the talks are interesting, but then there's much other things to do. And, like, yeah, but my boss doesn't give a shit. I'm like, I can appreciate that. So, anyway, so these other events we have, we mentioned the wireless ETF. It's what it sounds like. They have a bunch of different. I'm not going to go into it. Oh.
Keep going. It's next slide.
Next slide.
Just keep going.
Okay, keep cruising. Lockpick Village. If you've never picked a lock, I recommend stop by the Lockpick Village. What?
Nothing.
Okay. Should I just keep going?
Yeah, you're good.
Are you sure? I don't know if that's a sarcastic.
Potter comedy hour. Let's go. Keep going.
Okay. Amateur radio exams. We've been through. Oh, fire talks.
Fire talks. Well, so it's nothing. Nothing's changed, but they are an official ShmooCon event this year, which just means we made the guy who has been running it staff, so he gets the staff benefit of two maroon shirts.
Grex won't smell anymore. Yeah, this one guy is like, yeah! Thank God! Sorry, Grex. I don't know where he is, but I just did not make a friend. Hack Fortress and DCSS scannings.
Labs.
And labs, right. So, should I talk about labs now?
I've never stopped you.
Okay. So labs is an interesting one. A lot of conferences do training ahead of time, and it tends to be spendy, right? You got to pay like $1,000 per day or something like that. And we weren't really comfortable doing that kind of thing because somebody in there was going to make a bunch of money, and we didn't know how valuable it was going to be. So we decided, hey, let's do something where we just get smart people and cutting-edge gear together with people that want to learn how to use that gear and make them run our network and give them like an extra day ahead of time to set it up, to learn, to play around, to get everything working, and go. And so we've been doing ShmooCon Labs now for...
It's just the biggest scam ever, because they pay us to work for us.
Yeah. They actually give us $50. But in fairness, we give them a T-shirt.
They get a T-shirt.
And lunch. And a flashlight.
And this year we gave you a flashlight. Yeah. And a special badge.
Flashlight with an A. Just want to be super clear.
Bobby, cover your ears.
Yeah. No, it's okay. I appreciate the... I'm getting off track anyway. So what's interesting is that... this is an open kind of thing. Did I say that a lot?
Yes.
I'm sorry. It's interesting. So... We've had a lot of the same people coming back to labs every year, which is great. But some of the people that came to learn 5 years ago are now becoming experts. We would love to see...
At labs,
yeah, really. We would love to see more participation in labs. 25% new. So,
but we weren't full.
And we
still had a few spots left open. And it's a bargain, guys. $50 to work for me for a day.
Yeah. It's good times. So... anyway, I would encourage people that are interested in learning, think about applying for labs next year. It's a great experience. We try to take care of them. There's some great gear in there. And for those that, I mean, if you're here this year, all the way at the end of the hall, go check it out. They got visualization. They'll answer questions about how the network works, what they've got set up, and how everything functions. So.
And it's really one of those environments where you get out of it what you put into it. If you go in there and you're a wallflower, you're going to walk out a wallflower. But if you go in and ask questions and just involve yourself, mistakes happen. They're supposed to happen in that environment. I'd love to attend it. Never going to happen. 1 year when I quit.
All right, keep going.
I don't even know what to do.
Yeah, space.
Doesn't he do it already?
Oh my God. No. So to be super clear, she runs the con. I'm the figurehead, and a lot of people are like, you run a great con. I'm like, my wife runs a great con. I just lift the boxes and move them from one place to another, all week long. Every badge that you have. Can I talk about the badges now?
No.
No. I will not talk about the badges now. All right, contests, they're everywhere, literally everywhere. And I would encourage you to go participate. There's secret contests that you don't know about. If something looks kind of weird, I would encourage you to investigate why it looks weird.
Lots of the sponsors have contests. My son was just rocking the Rubik's Cube contest at one of the booths.
Yes. See something, say something contest? Wow. So...
I'm confused.
You know what happened here at this hotel in 1980? Yeah, Reagan got shot. This is the hotel Reagan got shot. You know why that's ironic? This is the like one hotel where there's an official presidential ball, and all this is like a football shape for purpose because there's not big lines of sight, so it was easier to protect the president. There's a back entrance here. The garage doors can come down. There's secret conference rooms.
But as it turns out, if you step outside,
Hinckley will get you. So, they've remodeled since then? What?
The outside?
Oh, well, anyway, I would encourage you not to get shot by John Hinckley or Hinckley Jr. So,
really anybody.
Anyone, really. It's bad for your health. So, the Saturday Night Party? So, the Saturday Night Party will be in this room. There's a dance floor here. If
yes,
you haven't seen
the
it.
Dance floor is already here.
It'll start at 9 o'clock. I had to look at my crotch to figure that out. Ow! Damn it. We printed all these cards. We have the badge printer. And we print all the... Thank you. I appreciate that, sir.
And then we give all those tiny ones to you, and we beg these off our staff that are much bigger.
But trying to explain to the guy who's selling my... oh, my God. What the fuck just happened here? I think we're having a political protest up front.
Keep going.
Okay, keep going. All right. All right, so the schedule...
Go back. You missed the key one there.
Oh. Look in your bags. So some of you...
No.
No?
I mean, yes.
Okay. You do it.
No. The point is, he's been yapping about all this stuff, but it's in your program. Look at it.
Oh, right. Sorry. Jeez. Yeah. Read the program. It's actually a really, really nice program. No, I didn't look at the program.
course he didn't. He didn't look at the program until it arrived at our house 2 days ago.
Yeah, anyway, read your program. There's a lot of stuff in it.
And you should look in your bags, because if you haven't learned by now to look in your bags, you are actually doing ShmooCon wrong.
Fireworks. All right, so you have these, the schedule cards. I was going to tell you about the schedule cards. So we print these on like an actual like Rio Magic Card printer. Anyone have a badge printer that you've used? Yeah, they're whatever. And so you buy these things, and then you get harassed by salespeople because they're like, oh, can I sell you more supplies? Do you need another printer? You know, whatever. And I'm trying to explain to the dude, like literally, I use it for 3 days a year, and I print 2,000 of the same thing. He's like, what do you mean? I'm like, I don't use it for identity and access control. I use it to print schedules. He's like, what does that mean? I'm like, oh my God. Like, you have, whoo. Anyway, and then it just sits in our house for 3 days and makes noise. Okay.
Oh, here's where your notes are.
Here's where my notes are. I have to orient myself.
Okay, so I'll help you.
Okay, thanks. So we're in the One Track Mind and Bring It On, and Build It is over that way, in the one that some of you walked into inadvertently by mistake, and then the Belay It is over there. Okay, there, thank you. I got that wrong a couple of years in a row, and it screwed a lot of people up. So anyway, these rooms will continue to be split all weekend. For the party, are they going to be joined together? Or
this party is just this room.
Just this room. Okay. All right.
All right. And we had said we were going to announce more tomorrow, but we are going to do the party entrance, same place we did last year if you were here. For all of you who raised your hand that or this is your first year, we're going to enter kind of where you came in tonight or today to come here. Thanks. The President's Walk. Thanks. Yes.
It's where all the pictures of the presidents are.
It's where all the pictures of the presidents are.
I just figured that out, by the way, that's why they call it the President's Walk. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
I didn't know Bruce Wayne was Batman either, so, you know.
Who here figured out that the lobby bar is closed?
What? Yeah.
I didn't know about that. Very good. Bobby, he's got one of those things. Melodica, thank you.
Melodica, yeah.
See, I knew that. Well, right? I had to ask, but, you know. So the Hilton very kindly set up, they're calling it the Hacker Lounge or the Hacker Hangout. Some of you have probably already seen it. It is exactly one floor up above us. Mornings and lunch will be like a grab and go, juices, sandwiches, burgers, I think wings, I don't know, just stuff. Coffee. They will, coffee. No, yes, coffee. Lots and lots of coffee. And then in the evenings, they're going to have a full bar up there. They'll have pizza and for purchase and I think it was burgers and a couple other things. So, and they've got tables and stuff. Yeah. I mean, they've got places to hang out. So what they've told me is that it'll be open till 10. But if it is busy, they'll keep it open later. That's on you.
Yeah. The and there's a gap in between the service, right?
Because they were
breaking
they need to
down at 2
and stuff like that.
And so then they'll be open again at 5 or whatever they open back up.
Yeah, I think I put it on the website or I'm not sure.
I saw some guy pleading with the dude up there like I'm just trying to buy something. He's like, all right, fine, because they were breaking down.
And to be clear, that is not a badged area. That's if you're lobby conning, you shouldn't be in here. But if you are lobby conning, you can go there too.
All right.
I wrote this slide and I said, I don't know.
Okay. So why do we do ShmooCon? One of the things that we've done, again, from the very beginning is this talk called Own the Con. And the idea is when we started this, and again, you know, Beetle was kind of the genesis of this way back when, there was, you know, what do you do? Like, how do you interact with the hotel? What do room commitments look like? How much money does it take to really run a con? How do you get the speakers wrangled? How do you deal with the attendees? All these questions. And, you know, all these questions that we had, and we thought, man, it'd be super cool if other people could learn from us, right? So we run this session called UnCon, where we give all the information that we can about how we run it, the financials behind it. We're not a nonprofit. But that's not to say we try to make money. We are an LLC just because it's easy, because running nonprofits are complicated and a pain in the ass. But we provide you all the financial information about how much revenue we get, how much we spend on the different things, so you know how much we spend on your swag, we know how much you spend on you know, the badges, the space, the party. The party is far and away the biggest expense, right? Like, nothing even comes close to touching it. And that's just because it's a hosted bar, right? And when you run a hosted bar for a couple thousand people in the hotel, I mean, the drinks run $6-$7 a drink?
Oh, no.
Eight, nine?
Oh, no.
Okay. They're expensive. But we'll drop, I mean, it's like $100,000 on the party. So,
you're talking about our party?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not cheap. But these are all things that people, you know, you can go. I know, like, you know, we've talked to B-Sides organizers, we've talked to other conference organizers. But even as attendees, I think it's important that you know what goes into this. Because when you go to other events, you can hold other people accountable to the experience that you expect for the money that you're providing, right? One of the reasons that we run this event, and the real genesis of ShmooCon, was years ago, we were at Vegas at either Black Hat or DEF CON. I can't remember what. We were at TourCon? Oh, we were at TourCon. Sorry, David, I'm going to throw him under the bus. So we were at TourCon.
If they can do it, we can do it too.
Yeah, well, there was, you know, we're there and like, man, we could totally pull this off. And then some dude was on stage and he was saying just something that was totally wrong, right? Like, he was just up there, like, spouting off random crap and nobody in the audience called him on it. And we're like, that's bullshit. Like, why does that happen? Like, why do you know, the people who in the audience who probably knew better, not stand up and say something? How does somebody get up on stage and not be held accountable to it? And there's a couple reasons. One, nobody wants to, like, raise their hand and be like, you're wrong. Because, A, like, you're usurping the speaker, right? That's a big thing to do. I mean, you could do it right now to me. But you're, like, suddenly the center of attention and making the statement, like, I'm more important than you and I'm going to tell you off. And in academic conferences, like, you can get away with that shit. Because, like, I'm a doctor and you're not. there's a few knowing giggles in the audience. But in a lot of cases, like, here, you don't. And the other, like, so how do you engage? So we started this con to try to facilitate meaningful discourse, to try to hold each other accountable, hold conference organizers accountable, hold the speakers accountable, hold the attendees accountable. And actually, that's why you have that squishy foam rubber ball. You may not have told the speakers about that, so we need to tell the speakers about the squishy foam rubber ball. That's actually a form of discourse, right? If you disagree with the speaker, and you don't want to stand up and be that person, you can just take it and from, like, behind your friend's head, like, throw it and pretend
very,
that they threw
very
it.
Very gently throw it.
Being the speaker with the ball.
Very That's gently.
Very gently do it.
Throw it.
So we, it's yeah, the chandelier. Don't hit the chandelier. So there's a couple, what?
What? Bruce.
Yeah, you can hit me as hard as you want. There was the snowpocalypse year where somebody had frozen Shmoo balls. That was dangerous. There was that was the same year where they had the Shmoo ball launching the Shmoo ball cannon contest. That happened exactly 1 year. So we're in
oh
a conference
gosh.
Room.
There's a great picture of it somewhere on the internet where the ball is like
right
here, and Bruce is like right here.
So this was when the shield's at home, shit. So there's this, somebody had built like some gas powered, like not like pulled power, but like compressed gas powered cannon. Larry had built it. And we were trying to figure out how fast these things go. And the iPhone had just come out, and there was an iPhone app that somehow gauged how fast something was moving based on taking a bunch of consecutive frames of the thing. And we thought, well, that's kind of bullshit, but we'll try it. And so, like, somebody's down low in front of the stage, and, you know, they're holding the button down, and they're getting speeds back when people are throwing the ball. It seemed reasonable, 30, 40, 50 miles an hour. Like, everything seems pretty cool. So then these machines start firing, and we get, like, 80 miles an hour, 70 miles an hour, whatever. And then Larry gets up with this thing and there's like steam coming off of it. He's like turning these knobs and all this kind of crap. And I'm like, oh my God. And so I'm up on stage as a target for this thing. And he's in the back of the room. And this dude's like down there real low. And Larry's like, okay, right. And he fires. And that ball comes up and hits me square in the chest, hurt like hell. Ask the guy on the iPhone. He's like, just says 200 plus. Like, it's just like, it's like, holy shit. Is that a sonic boom? Like, it was. And that was the end of it. We're like, nope, we're not doing this. Because if this is the first gen, like the second gen will be lethal. Like there'll be a ball-shaped hole. So the pushing the ball forward is a bit of a euphemism. Ha! But we feel pretty seriously that we want this to be a positive experience for you, both here, online, people that watch this stuff afterwards, to be able to materially make a change in our community and in the world at large. So that's why we try to be as open as we can. That's why we tried to structure events like we do. That's why we engage you and our sponsors and speakers and staff in the way that we do. We're always open to feedback. If you had feedback, concerns, questions, ideas on how to make this better, then by all means, please you know, let us know, and we certainly take all feedback to heart. So,
no white horse.
No whiteboards, yeah.
That was bad.
Yeah, thank you.
That was bad.
We tried to get away from the Shmoo Ball after the Shmoo Ball launching incident, actually, because I was a little nervous about, like, you know, losing my life savings in house because of a lawsuit. And so we tried, one year we tried ping pong balls. Who's here for the ping pong balls?
That was the first year, so he is way out of order here.
What?
Yep.
Were they?
Yep.
Oh.
Remember ISO specs, ping pongs, I don't know.
Well, so the one cute thing about that.
He says he knows nothing.
Was it really?
Yes.
No, it wasn't.
No, it was year two. You're right. It was year two. Thank you.
Who's that? Toby going all old school on us? Oh, man, badass.
He's right. The first year were those yellow, like, bath
Nerf
sponges.
Balls. Yeah, those were terrible. You couldn't, like.
All right, so moving,
right. Moving along.
Whatever. The how is basically all these maroon shirts you're seeing out here. We operate this conference with just under 90 volunteers. Our return rate on our volunteers is super, super high. It's awesome. We've got collectively just this amazing team that comes and helps and put on this conference every year. And so we are very thankful for that. The Shmoo Group in general is very thankful for that. And I think all of you should be thankful for that as well.
Yay, volunteers!
Okay. But there are three people who work very, very hard to make this happen.
What? Come on up, boys. Come on, Dax. Oh, was he really? Okay.
He wasn't.
Hi.
So in our household, I'm just going to read this. December is the month that our parents lock us in the garage and don't let us come out until the patches are done. And that's kind of not a lie. Taryn, who's home from college, yes, I have one in college, spent almost, besides getting his wisdom teeth pulled, spent almost his entire break in our garage with two little propane heaters, you know, shivering, cutting the badges that all of you are wearing around your necks. Bobby, our freshman in high school, designed one of the badges and actually designed one of the shirts, which you'll see later, but it's the shirt that Daxton's wearing. So. And Daxton, who helps us with a lot of things. You were punching badges for us, weren't you? And you helped clean. Oh, our kids actually hand-cleaned every single badge you're wearing as well, because we felt a little bad. They were kind of dusty. So they don't do dishes at our house. They do badges. But Daxton was washing badges one of the nights, and he's looking at it, and he's like, Mom, Dad, isn't this supposed to say 2017? And we're like, Yeah, it is. Good job. Good reading, son. And he goes, no, isn't it supposed to say 2017? And we're like, yeah, totally says 2017. Do you remember this? What did it say? Do you remember what it said instead? What did it say instead?
I don't know.
Instead of 2017, do you remember what it said? It said 2107. And Daxton said, but Mommy, it says 2107. And Bruce and I went,
Dope.
And luckily, we'd only cut like 200 of those so far, right? No, okay. I was told we only cut two. We overnighted more badge material.
Which I did.
Yeah, so we were like, I mean, so that was a Super Mario design, for those that have seen that one. And we had cut probably 400 out of 600 and change that we had to cut. So we were pretty far through that run. Those ones took the longest because they have the highest density of things that have to cut vertically on it. And I designed them. He printed them. Neither of us caught it. We were inside scrubbing them, and it takes a six-year-old to be like, hello! And
anyway, so they've been helping us out with this since day one. This is their life. They don't know anything. Well, this one certainly doesn't know anything different than ShmooCon every January. He's like, what are you talking about? What's ShmooCon? So we just felt that at least for 1 year, we would hijack the stage and tell our boys that we're incredibly proud and thankful for everything that they put up with during the few weeks before the con. And indeed, actually every day of their lives with us. But it's a little amplified during con prep time. So anyway, thank you. Love you. Thanks, boys.
Dex is gone. Yeah. It's funny, like when you don't want him on stage, he's like, I'm gonna run around. When you want him on stage, he's like, no. And he is embarrassed. So on that note, are you really leaving me?
No.
No, you don't have, you can, it's fine. I can do this by man. So every year, we get up on stage.
Hang on.
Go ahead.
It's not child labor, they're family, and they're allowed to work for us.
Insourcing. Oh, yeah, I said outsourcing earlier. That didn't feel right. You're totally correct. Insourcing. Children, insource the dishes. So anyway, every year we do our opening, and I do a little rant sometimes of little importance. Sometimes I get all wound up. This year... some years we've run out of time because I go on too long. And so you can disregard as much as what I'm about to tell you if you like, but I feel compelled to have a bit of a heart-to-heart with everybody here about the state of our industry and what's going on. And again, you can disagree with me, you can argue with me, and we can have it out right now, and I'm totally down with that. For those of you that know me, like, I'm not afraid to talk about this shit. She's literally going to leave me alone.
I'm going to sit over here.
Yeah, so I don't often talk about a lot of the work that I do, not because it's like super secret ninja, but I don't feel it's that important for my ego or anything to talk about the types of things that I do. I'm pretty quiet about trying to help people and do my thing. For those that don't know, I'm the CTO of the KeyW Corporation during the day, and I started a company and sold it to KeyW about 2 years ago and had a great team of about 40 people working for me. And had a grand old time with that. And in the last year, I was lucky enough to serve as the technical advisor to the Presidential Commission on Cybersecurity. So you may have read the report recently. I worked along with the commission and NIST and the Department of Commerce and went around the country and interviewed people and helped them with all the meetings that they had and that kind of thing. And it was eye-opening, right? Like, to be able to spend a year talking with people of that caliber from financial, from academic, from energy, military, civil agencies, and hear what the concerns were and what they thought would make the world better, what they thought was making the world worse. And a number of things struck me, and I want to share some of kind of my revelations on what 2016 was and what we need to think about going forward. First of all, the commission was called the Commission on Cybersecurity, and I know we still sometimes piss on that word. And I, you may have been here when I went off on that a couple years ago. I think Erin might have told me to drink, and I may have gotten a little barky at her about it. And I still feel a little bad. So it's like, fuck you!
16.
The one thing is, cyber covers everything. When I use that term, I use it specifically, and I would encourage you to use it specifically when you use it, right? It's hard to have a word that encompasses information assurance, cyber defense, or computer network defense, software security, offensive and defensive work. I mean, all these kind of things. Cyber is just a convenient term to roll it all up under, right? It's not having sex on IRC anymore. It's a real word. Because if it was, and you listen to the Senate confirmation stuff, it's really funny to think about senators asking other senators about cyber sex on IRC. ASL? I don't know. I'm like an 85-year-old white guy in the Senate. Who are you? I hope there's a post writer in here. That'll be great cover material. Should not have identified my employer earlier. But I would encourage you to be specific in your use of terminology going forward, right? Like, so A, please just accept cyber as a thing, but also then recognize the sub-disciplines that are really becoming more formal in the work that we do every day. I mean, these hacker cons used to have a relatively small group of people associated with them that all kind of had similar skill sets. You know, some people are better at one thing than another, but you know, anyone working in corporate America knows that we have huge bifurcation between policy people to penetration testers, right? People that write secure software and understand how to integrate security into a DevOps and CI/CD environment are totally different critters than people that configure a firewall, right? Like, there's almost no common ground except for the fundamentals of like CIA and a few other basic concepts. There's almost no common ground anymore. And we need to accept that. So A, like, I'm gonna use the term cyber get over it. I would encourage you to use the term, but then understand and work as a really community to figure out where these delineations are occurring and where we have kind of different trades, different skill sets that we can really put a bright box on and say, you're different, you're different, you're different, and use those terms specifically. What really struck me of what happened in the last year is that cybersecurity has turned into a societal problem. Right, we have gone from a realm where we as practitioners were the ones with the dark arts, and we understood how this worked, and when things went right, we celebrated. When things went wrong, we would troll you and point, and the world at large wouldn't give a shit, right? And then breaches started happening, and you know, breaches are tough, but at the end of the day, normal consumers don't suffer because of breaches, right? We don't. There's too many of them. Right? Credit card numbers are like, hey, I can hand my credit card out right now and I don't have any liability for it, right? I don't, go ahead. Bring it on. And like whole people begging up here, man. There's a lot of jobs to be had. We don't need to be begging. And like full blown identity theft, right? There's just only so many criminals out there willing to commit that kind of activity, right? Criminals are going to crime, right? They're going to make money that they need to make, but there's really a limit. It's the same thing, like, as a parent, you're like, there's a pedophile behind every tree. Like, no, there's just grass behind every tree, right? Behind every, like, 1 trillionth tree, there's a pedophile. Your kids can walk around, and it's generally safe. It's really hard to accept the risk associated with a breach as a consumer. And so consumers, you know, first wildly oscillated, said, I am never going to shop at Target again. And then all these breaches happen, and they're like, whatever, here's my card, I don't give a shit anymore. and so, you know, you got consumers who don't understand risk, and then suddenly, you know, we had the 2016 election cycle. You know, Russian involvement, all kinds of people throwing accusations back and forth. I mean, half the Senate hearings are about hacking and cybersecurity. The term hacking gets used in all kinds of super painful ways, right? And you just grit your teeth every time you hear it. But again, just substitute. There's a substitution, some word that you can use when they use it that it makes sense. So suddenly, it's not just front page news, but it's kitchen table news in rural Kansas, right? That's different. That's a different problem. Now, I would think, we know this is a hard industry to understand. We will disagree about things. Like, we can disagree about whether or not my weak cipher on SSL is important. I would posit that, fuck you, it's not.
You said cybersecurity.
Oh, yeah. I'm drinking some good stuff today. I will drink, but I'll drink to the man, not the word. Anyway, man, I lost my goddamn train of thought. Like, I didn't even do the shot. Oh, yeah, SSL. Thank you. So first of all, find me the criminal who's cracked SSL to steal a credit card.
Or got a shell
from cracking SSL. No, it doesn't happen, right? Like, the amount of computation time you would spend to crack that weak cipher far exceeds in cost the value that you would get from the off chance that there's a fucking credit card number in that session, right? Don't email me about a weak cipher in SSL. It's not a thing. I don't give a shit, right? You should not give a shit either, right? It is not a big red critical when you have a bad cipher on SSL, okay? It's a big, what?
Can I get a bug bounty?
Right. I have a bug bounty going, and like 8,000 people are like, here's what's wrong with your web server, and it's all SSL. It's like, no, it's a fuck you.
18.
Oh, my God. Anyway, so, you know, we struggle with these issues. Like, we will have discussions about whether or not this is important. Think about the conversations that happen all over America by people that don't actually know how computers work, okay? An example, I go to get barbecue a couple weeks ago at a place called Canopy, Central Maryland chain. They have really good barbecue, pit beef. If you don't know what pit beef is, kind of a regional thing. They put beef in a pit, it's pit beef. Yeah, creative. Tried to explain sous vide to them and they threw me out. So I was in there, and this was during the Dyn DNS attack, right, during the denial of service. And so I walk in, And one of the guys is saying, like, I couldn't play a game or something. Like, I don't know if PSN or some one of the networks was affected by it. And I'm like, yeah, it's because of that denial of service attacks going on. The other guy's like, yeah, man, I heard about that. I'm like, yeah, it's, and I'm about to, like, give him a little bit of background about what's going on. And he gives me a little bit of background about what's going on. And I will tell you the two takeaways that I had from this. One, he told me that all traffic for the internet is routed through Europe. There's one place in Europe where all the traffic goes to. And the attackers had taken over that traffic, and because of that, they were able to steal all the credit cards from the PlayStation network. I'm like looking for the cameras, and I'm like... So I try to explain to him what's going on. He's like, no, it all goes through Europe. And I'm like, okay, like there's nothing... I'm not gonna have a conversation with this man that's gonna change his mind that the dude working behind the counter selling me pit beef, that all the internet traffic in the world goes through like a server in Europe. A server in Europe. So it's a big server. It's at least like a dual proc, right? Like quad core, it's a quad core. They'll upgrade it to like an A9 soon. So anyway, you know, the average consumer doesn't understand the internet and how computers work, and it's still a dark art. But suddenly they're worried about these things. It affects them, and it affects everything around us. We all argue with each other, and we'll bitch and complain and be like, you're wrong, because you agree with the right or the left about the attribution of this thing, or you're wrong because it was IoT or it's not IoT and whatever. People just, they just want their shit to work, and they want their government to work, and they want it to work their way. Right? Well, it doesn't work their way, they get angry, and that's society being angry. That's not us as geeks being angry. So what we're seeing now is we used to control all that. We controlled a lot of that message. We controlled the technology. And we're turning into cogs in the machine, right? The stuff that's happening up on the hill right now, this second, is happening in the absence of all of us, right? They are making policy. They are putting people in cabinet positions. They're doing all kinds of things right now that they're trying to do, from their judgment, is in the best interest of society. And suddenly, we're going to be people that get turned into big machine in order to work against those initiatives. Because everything that happens on the Hill is going to have economic impact on every private enterprise in the country, right? Good or bad, right or left, I don't give a shit, right? This stuff is transcending, and it's getting beyond us. We are going to be little pegs. What? I'm not even touching that shit. I'm honest to God, I have my own opinions on all these, and I'm not going to get onto it on stage. I want to give you guys something to think about. Jack's still waving the Trump mask around awkwardly. But as our companies, as our governments, and as a citizenry come to grips with these concepts that they don't actually understand how it works, we can poo-poo their lack of knowledge, and we can try to troll them, but they're not going to give a shit. Right? Society is going to continue to evolve, and we're going to have bigger and bigger, bigger problems as people use computers not just for breaches, but now for disinformation campaigns, for propaganda, control of the media, control of the press, right? All these, man, citizen journalism was great, and then it became a nightmare, right? Because all of journalism was real, and now it's not, right? We are in a weird space with that stuff. How do we play into that? I don't freaking know, but we're going to play a role, right? I feel pretty passionately. It's our job to protect journalists, right? I am a big fan of freedom of the press. So that gets to, like, what do we do? The so what? Like, I hate giving a talk that doesn't give you an action, right? Or at least something you can disagree with, right? And I've given them. I know I've gotten up here some years and been like, hey, the world's falling apart, fuck off, and I walk off the stage. And that's not what I want to do today. I do want to think things that we shouldn't do, in my opinion. There's been, since the Mirai botnet issue, there's been a lot of people in our community saying, why can't the government get more involved in IoT security? No. Well, Whitney's like, well, Jesus, that's what we're trying to do. With 800-171, for the people that are under 800-171, the rest of the world's like, what the hell's 800-171? I would encourage you, actually, as private industry not involved with the federal government, go read NIST 800-171 for an actually interesting document around specific controls that you could implement in your enterprise. It's worth the read. It's better than reading, say, 853, which will put your ass to sleep. I'm just being real. It's a big-ass document, man. 853 is the big book of cyber, right? It's everything you could do. Yes. So we need to be cautious about regulation, right? What's a wonderful thing about regulation? It has all kinds of unintended consequences. All kinds of unintended consequences. When you go and tell D-Link, hey, you gotta have all these things in your system, and then you start levying that upon a bunch of other vendors, smaller vendors may not be able to do that. You know what drives our economy? Innovation, small business, people inventing shit. What's a great thing about the internet and software? Anyone can do it. What's the shitty thing about the internet and software? Anybody can do it. Right? From a security perspective, it's terrifying. But when you start levying these requirements through regulation and law, suddenly it's really hard for the small person to get involved, right? And I'm not saying you can't regulate, and I'm not saying there shouldn't be laws, but it has to be done in a way that doesn't bias against pre-existing ideas and away from people with new and innovating concepts. So the IoT thing is fascinating because my opinion on Mirai and IoT is that it was bullshit, right? What was in the Mirai botnet? CCTV cameras, right? The core of it was that Chinese, just a thing, the little widget that was integrated in a lot of other people's systems, but it was largely just video cameras. When I have a video system that I'm trying to view over the internet, what do I need to do? Well, what I should do is put it behind a VPN and do certificates and control access. What do I do if I don't give a shit? I plug it right into the fucking internet. It's easy. There's a lot of IoT stuff, like the vast majority of IoT work that I've done, lives behind firewalls. As a matter of course, it may live in your goddamn body, right? It lives in all kinds of places that aren't on the internet. Those cameras live on the internet as a matter of convenience. A lot of stuff, like your refrigerator, isn't on the goddamn internet. What bothers me is the central service that they all talk to. Hacking a refrigerator because I drove to your house, connected to your Wi-Fi, and hacked it, and made all your eggs go bad, is trolling, right? If I connect to the refrigerator company's web service, I hack it, and then I tell all the refrigerators from that manufacturer to go to 50 degrees and destroy everyone's eggs, it has economic impact, right? That's an actual cyber attack. So, yeah, trolling grocery stores. It's my plan to get Kroger's stock to go up. So, we need to be careful when we use Mirai as the foil to go after IoT as a security problem. Right? Because it's really going after internet-connected cameras and people that were too lazy to put them behind firewalls and do VPNs, which is different than your pacemaker, which is different than valve control systems on industrial systems, and it's different than your refrigerator. These are all very different problems. So saying what's IoT and what's not is hard. Saying what's the responsibility of the user and what's not the responsibility of the user, I would encourage us also not to victim blame. Okay? It's hard to run a secure network. No shit, you're thinking, right? Well, when I'm a small business and I do something that's, say, not computer-related, like run a dry cleaner, what the hell? Like, I'm just going to buy a point-of-sale system. Two examples. If you follow my Twitter account, I apologize. I'm going to reiterate the same shit I said the other day. And I've said it to a number of people. If I run a dry cleaner and somebody throws a brick through my window, I get to call the cops, first of all. The cops come and investigate. If I have video footage, they'll actually put a detective on it and try to find the person that did it. Right? They don't say, well, you had shitty glass. I'm like, well, I had see-through glass, right? The non-see-through glass is called brick. They will help me, and the bad person in that equation is the person that threw the brick through the window. If, now on the other hand, my point-of-sale system got hacked over the internet because somebody knew the default password on my router because I didn't know how to change it, and it came that way from the telephone company, and then they got into my point-of-sale system, also with the default password. They had no idea it even existed, and they stole a bunch of credit card numbers. I'm the bad guy because I didn't change my password. And when I call the local cops and say, my cash register got broken into over the internet, they're like, who gives a shit? The local cops don't investigate. So I call the FBI and I say, I lost $400. They're like, you should probably go take a lesson in cybersecurity. I'm like, that sounds great. I have no legal backstop as a small business in that case. And it's my responsibility, it's my fault that somebody broke in. And we'll mock these people for not changing their passwords. These people who think the entire internet runs through Europe and we expect them to change the password in their point of sale system. It's total bullshit, right? That's not an okay thing for us to do anymore. How hard is it to explain to someone how to lock their door with a key? Can you do it in 5 seconds?
No.
Shut up.
He can't Hey, you put the key in, you turn it to the right, you pull on the doorknob. Is it locked? Yes. Okay. How do I secure my home network? I'll come over, we'll drink some beers, we'll talk about it. And then for the next couple of weeks, and then I'll run a vulnerability scan against you, and then I'll war drive your neighborhood. I got a product for you. Go to Best Buy. Talk to the Geek Squad. So go to the FBI. Call the FBI, they'll help you out. What about more people, right? We need more of us. God, because there's a lot of us. Maybe if we just had more of us, that would help solve the problem. I don't know if you've ever heard of root cause analysis, but the problem we have isn't that we have too few people, it's that all our stuff sucks, right? And throwing more people at the problem just costs more money. We need a bigger con, yeah, sure. No, we're not having that discussion. What we need is better stuff, right? From beginning to end, we need to build better systems, we need to develop them in a secure fashion, we need to test them better, we need to operate them more securely, and then we need to sunset them at appropriate times, right? And that's on us as IT and security professionals, not normal consumers, right? I don't blame normal consumers for stupid stuff. There's people who got their LG TVs popped by ransomware because they went to like some offline app store or whatever. Whatever. You should be, as a user, free to be as stupid as you want, as far as I'm concerned. At least we should build systems that allow that, right? This idea that we need more people, I don't think holds water. I think it's a short-term solution because the pain is so great. There's only things that humans can do, right? You have analysts. If you think of the people that have been analysts in this room for a long period of time, over time the technology's gotten better, but guess what? You're still a goddamn analyst, right? You're still looking at the data because you just have better tools, you can ingest more, but the scale of the problem's gotten better, the adversary's gotten better, you're still a human in the loop. There was a story in the Wall, I think it was in the Journal yesterday, the day before, the problem with AI is that there's still people in it, right? It's a great article, you should go read it. There's all this money being thrown at AI and ML in our industry and others. It turns out there's still a human somewhere doing a bunch of work because it's like artificially kind of intelligent. And it's machines stumbling around, learning. Like, it's not quite there yet, and it hasn't been for 40 years, and it's not going to be for a while. We're still going to have humans in the loop. We need better technology so that we all are more efficient. We also need to stop acting like we have the solution, right? We may have a part of it. We may have some concept of what the solution space looks like. We don't freaking know, right? Especially as we're being held to higher account by society in general, we need to admit we don't know what the solution is. That our industry is an experimental science, that we will fail all the fucking time. And until we accept that and learn from our failures and stop pretending that we know what we're gonna do, we're never gonna get any better, right? So please, in the next year, admit to yourself, we are failing, and that's okay, right? Learn from your failure. Learn to be responsible to each other. Learn to be responsible to society at large, right? That's our job. There's a lot more people relying on us to do our job and to do it correctly and be grown-up goddamn adults about it than there ever have been. The problem is going to get worse. It's up to you to learn. It's up to you to mentor. It's up to you to be the next generation to make this better. So anyway, I'm really amped up, so that's all I got. In slightly more pedestrian news, the parking situation. got to come down a little bit. Otherwise, parking!
I got it. I can do this one.
You can do it.
I can do parking.
Okay.
I can do parking. There.
Bow to my. Yeah, that worked. Okay.
That shirt just got made.
Yeah.
I married this guy.
Oh, wow. Oh, shit.
Oh, there was a count.
There was a count. You want to do that?
Okay. Fuck 22? 22 times? Shit was 18 and goddamn was 4.
Wow. Goddamn made the cut. That's cool.
That's pretty cool.
Let's hear it for goddamn. Well, yeah. It's been promoted.
Okay. Just real quick. There is a parking discount. If you're staying at the hotel, it should already be applied to you because of your room. If not, my understanding is that there are parking concierges down there. You just have to tell them that you're with the conference and you get the discount. That doesn't work. Let me know. We'll fix it.
Yeah.
Anyway. Yeah. So
the photography rule. So Some of you may have never been to a conference that has photography rules. Old school HackerCon's kind of had this for a long time. We've carried this on. People enjoy their anonymity. Anonymity is really wicked hard, right? Wicked hard in this day and age. She has a burner phone that we use for circumstances like this, and it's funny because, man, Android phones want you to talk to Google in the worst goddamn way. Like, everything, like, are you sure you don't want me to configure a Google account for you? Like, no! There's not like one giant un-Googleify Android button. That's what I would love. So anonymity is tough. Our photography policy is straightforward. Everybody in frame needs to agree to be in frame when the picture's taken, period. This is not a negotiable thing. This applies to attendees, speakers. You can't be like, hey, I'm talking at ShmooCon, poof, and pop a picture of everybody in the audience. That's not okay. It's not okay to shoot shots in the hallway. It's not okay to just shoot random shots of people. If it happens once, we're going to ask you to delete the photo and not do it again. If it's a habit, we're going to ask you to leave. It's not complicated. We're very serious about it, though. All of our staff take it seriously. We do have two official staff photographers.
And they follow
exactly the same rules. They do not take photos that people don't want to be in frame on, and they're very good about it. So they've been doing this a long time, and we appreciate their work at capturing an event that really doesn't like to be captured at times. So with that said,
we've got about 20 minutes until our first talk.
20 minutes
so,
until our first talk.
Wow.
Yeah.
I know.
I got really amped up early. No, we're done. And just so you know, we will stream all 3 days. So I know some people are here a day or whatever. You go home, you can watch them online. They'll be on archive.org. Big thanks to archive.org for actually hosting all this. I don't mean this in an offensive way, but we don't want unintended people making money off of your efforts and our efforts. So that's why we host on Archive as opposed to like YouTube or some other place like that.
So go watch them on Archive.
Yeah, so please watch them on Archive. Don't repost them on YouTube. Archive's great. And also, you know, Jason Scott's down the street or down the hallway. So if you want to thank Archive.org, just give him a big hug. So. Wow, that got a weird look. Anyway, with that, thank you very much for coming to ShmooCon.